General method for work energy approach for solving problems which involve rigid body moving in a plane is basically same as what I gave you before for the particles. The only difference being that the expression for the kinetic energy for rigid bodies moving in a plane is different from the kinetic energy expression for a particle. So let me reiterate that method just for the sake of completion. So the first part, the step one, is to apply a test. And the test itself has two parts. One is that this is a finite displacement problem. So what's a finite displacement problem? You are given a rigid body in one position and the rigid body moves from this position to another position. So this could be a general planar motion as it goes from here to here. It could be a pure rotation about a fixed point. It could be a pure translation. Doesn't matter. It's a finite displacement problem. So you're not really doing instantaneous analysis. The second part of the test says that you are relating the forces moment with displacement. And displacement I can write as linear displacement or angular displacement. And the change in speed, which could be linear or it could be angular velocity. So you can see that, you know, our previous method didn't have any theta and omega because we didn't have any rotation or change in orientation of the particles. But for rigid bodies, displacements can involve theta and omega, and you can also have the couples applied on the rigid body, right? So that's another difference between the work energy method for the particles versus rigid bodies. So if the test is positive, then you proceed further and you go to the second step where you choose and show your coordinate system along with position variables. So if your position variables, if your position variable is a linear one, then you show just that. If you have an angular position variable, you show that. If you have more than, you know, one of those, then you show all of them. Step three is to do as much kinematic analysis, the goal being to get velocity of the center of mass and the angular velocity of the rigid body. So if you have one rigid body, you want to determine both of these quantities as much as possible. If you have more than one rigid body, you want to determine both of these quantities for all of them. Okay. Step four is to draw free body diagram. And if you have more than one, then it's in plural, in an intermediate, let me say, or generic position. So why intermediate or generic position? Well, that's because you don't want to draw your free body diagram in a position, in an orientation where certain forces of the moments may be clearly zero, and you may conclude that there is no work done by those forces. The next step is to identify forces and moments, or I could also say couples, that do work. Okay, and then among the forces that do any work, you will further look for the forces that are conservative and the forces that are non-conservative forces. Okay, so if the forces are, if forces are conservative, then you can use conservation of mechanical energy principle, which says T1 plus V1 equal to T2 plus V2, where T1 is the initial kinetic energy, T2 is the final kinetic energy, and we know that for rigid body, kinetic energy expression would be 1/2 mvg square plus 1/2 ig omega square. For particles, you didn't have the second term, okay? V1 is a potential energy function due to various forces acting, and V2 is the potential energy function in the final position. So the definition of the potential energy function, of course, doesn't change just because we are dealing with rigid bodies. If you have non-conservative forces as well, so if forces are non-conservative, then clearly you cannot use the conservation mechanical energy principle. Then you are left to use the general expression, which relates to work done due to conservative forces plus work done due to non-conservative forces equal to change in kinetic energy. And you will have to write down the work done due to non-conservative forces. You'll have to evaluate them based on the nature of those forces. Finally, that will be step number 7. You will identify unknowns and solve for them. Of course, work energy approach will give you only one scalar equation for one rigid body, and that means you'll be able to solve for at most one unknown. Now let's do a few examples that show how we can apply our general method. So this is example 8.2, solve example from your textbook. The work energy principle for rotation about a fixed axis. So in this problem, we have a manually operated road barrier. So let me draw that. Point B, and this is the center of mass A. So that's the road barrier, and it's constrained to rotate about fixed point O. So it can basically go up and down in a vertical plane about point O. The manually operated road barrier shown in this figure is easily opened and closed by hand due to the counterweight. So right over here is the counterweight. Referring to the figure, model the arm of the barrier as a uniform thin bar of mass MA. So this road barrier is modeled as a rigid body, which is a bar, mass MA, that is pinned at point O and with mass center at A, and model the counterweight as a particle of mass MC. So this counterweight over here is modeled as a particle MC. Determine the angular velocity of the arm and the speed of NB. So we're looking for the angular velocity of the arm and the speed of the NB. So we're looking for the linear velocity of the point B, so V sub B. As the arm reaches the horizontal position, if it is nudged from rest when it is at vertical and falls freely. So this whole rod or the road barrier swings about point O, and initially it's in a vertical position, and then it is allowed to fall freely due to the gravity in one direction. So the question is, when it reaches the horizontal position, what is its angular velocity and what is the linear velocity of the point B? Evaluate your answers for given values of L, which so L is the total length. D, so D is the distance from O to the end point of this bar. And delta, which is the distance from O to the counterweight. So that's delta. A 45-pound arm, so we know the mass of the arm, and a 160-pound counterweight. Okay. So we know the masses, we know all these lengths, and we know all these distances. We should apply our test first. So is this a finite displacement problem? Yes. We have an initial position which is vertical, then we have a final position which is horizontal. The question is asking to find the omega and the linear velocities. So there's no acceleration, there's no angular acceleration asked for, which means that test is positive, right? Okay, so what we'll do is we'll start by showing the coordinate system. So let's say this is our x-axis, this is our y-axis, all right? And then we will try to do as much kinematic analysis as we can do, okay? So this is doing a pure rotation about point O. So writing the velocity of the center of mass, okay, at any instant is simple. So V sub A is actually equal to the distance from O to A. And that would be basically L by 2 minus D times the angular velocity. So there's a definite relationship between A and O, because O is the center of rotation, right? So you could write your relative velocity equation, which says velocity of A is equal to velocity of O plus omega cross R, right? So this is actually opt-in. Let me write that. Velocity of A equal to velocity of O plus omega cross R of A, which is to O, and velocity of O is zero. And this is what you'll get. So the reason I'm directly writing this equation over here is because I know I need only scalar quantities, which are the speed. And that's the reason why I'm not bothering to do, you know, cross products and things like that. Similarly, velocity of the B can be written as distance from O to B, which is L minus D times omega. So if we can find the omega, right, then we will know everything, okay? All right, now let's draw the free body diagram, and we'll draw the free body diagram in a generic configuration, okay? So I'm going to redraw this. So we have point O over here, and let's say, you know, our rod. somewhere in between from vertical to horizontal positions like this. So the forces acting are O sub X, O sub Y. So actually I made a mistake. I shouldn't show this, support over here, because the moment I show OX and OY, you know, that support goes away, right? So I have, you know, just this. Then I have at point A, gravity acting downward, okay? And then we also have the gravity of the counterweight. So we also have the counterweight here. And then we have the weight of the counterweight, so as MCG. And those are the only forces acting on this road barrier, right? Now let's identify the forces that do any work or not. So clearly, OX and OY will not do any work. Why? Because the point O is a fixed point, right? So F dot dr is the definition of the work done. Dr is zero, there's no displacement of the point O, so there's no work done by OX and OY. Will there be any work done by MG and MCG? Yes, these points A and the point C, where the counterweight is, are moving up and down. So there will be, of course, work done by the gravity. Because it's a conservative force, we can use conservation of mechanical energy principle. So let's do that. So T1 plus V1 equal to T2 plus V2. So we have to also draw the vertical configuration to see, you know, what it would look like. So let me see if I can, you know, I'll have to draw it all over again. Okay, so let's do that. So this is initial configuration. Here is point O. Here is my counterweight C. Okay. I have to pick a datum. So I can pick my datum going through this point O. That's point A. So what is T1? T1 is equal to zero because initially everything is at rest. You gave it just a nudge. What's V1? V1 is going to be potential energy due to all the conservative forces. The only force we have here is the gravity. So let's write the potential energy function due to gravity. So from the datum, point A is a distance. So what is this distance? This is L by 2 minus D. So this is L by 2 minus D times mg, right? Where m is the mass of the rod. So notice how we're looking at the y value of the center of mass above the datum, and it's positive above the datum. Then we have the potential energy due to the counterweight, right? And that is below the datum by distance delta. So that is actually minus mcg times delta, right? That's the V1 for initial position. Okay, now we get to the second position, which is the horizontal position, and we are looking for T2 and V2. So let's write V2 first. So V2 is going to be, this is the datum, right? V2 is going to be zero because the center of gravity for both the counterweight as well as the rod is going through the datum. So V2 is actually zero, which is good. So T2 is equal to now the kinetic energy of the rod and the counterweight, right? So what is the kinetic energy of the rod? It's 1/2 m times VA squared plus 1/2 IG times omega squared plus the kinetic energy of the particle, the counterweight, which doesn't have any rotation. So it will be simply 1/2 its mass times velocity of C squared, right? Okay, so let's write all these things. So T2 is equal to 1/2 mass. So this is actually MA. MA times VA. Now VA from our analysis, kinematic analysis, L by 2 minus D omega. So let's substitute that. So we get L by 2 minus D times omega. So this becomes squared. This becomes a square. That's 1/2. This is IG. So that's MA times L squared over 12. Because that's the most mass moment of inertia for a rod about the center of mass. Times omega squared. Plus the final term, which is 1/2 MC. And what is VC? VC is a linear velocity, and that is actually delta times omega, right? So, you know, in my kinematic analysis, I could have added that VC is equal to delta times omega. So this is actually delta omega squared, and that's T2. So now, if you substitute for T1, V1, V2, and T2 in this formula over here, what do you get? Well, you have only one unknown, which is omega. There's only one unknown. So you can solve for omega from this analysis then once you substitute for the numbers. I'm not substituting numbers over here because it'll probably take me 10 minutes just to do that, and there's no point. You guys can do that calculation. So once you substitute omega in here, that'll give you the velocity of the point A, and the problem would be solved.